Thank you all devotees. I'm honored to be with all of you and very grateful for inviting me again. And I've been given the verse 5:8:26, right? Yeah. So since it's a prose, it is not a shloka, I would like to read the translation. And is that okay? I'll read the translation and then we can have the class. Okay. Translation and purport by His Divine Grace, Srila A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Srila Prabhupada. Before that, we'll offer prayers. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Narayanam Namaskrityam Naram Chaiva Narottamam Devim Sarasvatim Vyasam Tato Jaya Mudhiraye Nashta Prayeshu Abhadreshu Nityam Bhagavata Sevaya Bhagavati Ruttama Shloke Bhaktir Bhavati Naishtaki Krishnaya Vasudevaya Devaki Nandanaya Cha Nanda Gopa Kumaraya Govindaya Namo Nama Namo Pankaja Nabhaya Namo Pankaja Maline Namo Pankaja Netraya Namaste Pankajangre. The translation. Shukdev Goswami continued, "My dear King, in this way Bharat Maharaj was overwhelmed by an uncontrollable desire which was manifest in the form of the deer. Due to the fruitive results of his past deeds, he fell down from mystic yoga, austerity and worship of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. If it were not due to his past fruitive activity, how could he have been attracted to the deer after giving up the association of his own son and family, considering them stumbling blocks on the path of spiritual life? How could he show such uncontrollable affection for a deer? This was definitely due to his past karma. The king was so engrossed in petting and maintaining the deer that he fell down from his spiritual activities. In due course of time, insurmountable death, which is compared to a venomous snake that enters the hole created by a mouse, situated itself before him." Purport. As will be seen in later verses, Bharat Maharaj at the time of death would be forced to accept the body of a deer due to his attraction for the deer. In this regard, a question may be raised. How can a devotee be affected by his past misconduct and vicious activities? In Brahma Samhita 5.54, it is said, "Karmani nirdahati kintu cha bhakti bhajam." For those engaged in devotional service, bhakti bhajana, the results of past deeds are indemnified. According to this, Bharat Maharaj could not be punished for his past misdeeds. The conclusion must be that Maharaj Bharat purposefully became over addicted to the deer and neglected his spiritual advancement. To immediately rectify his mistake, for a short time, he was awarded the body of a deer. This was just to increase his desire for mature devotional service. Although Bharat Maharaj was awarded the body of an animal, he did not forget what had previously happened due to his purposeful mistake. He was very anxious to get out of his deer body, and this indicates that his affection for devotional service was intensified, so much so that he was quickly to attain perfection in a Brahmana body in the next life. It is with this conviction that we declare in our Back to Godhead magazine that devotees like the Goswamis living in Vrindavan, who purposely commit some sinful activity, are born in the bodies of dogs, monkeys and tortoises in that holy land. Thus, they take on these lower life forms for a short while, and after they give up those animal bodies, they are again promoted to the spiritual world. Such punishment is only for a short period and it is not due to past karma. It may appear to be due to past karma, but it is offered to rectify the devotee and bring him to pure devotional service. ओम अज्ञान तिमिरंधस्य ज्ञानांजनाशलाकया चक्षुरुन्मीलितं येन तस्मै श्री गुरुवे नमः। मूकं करोति वाचालं पंगुं लंगयते गिरिं यत्कृपातमहं वंदे श्री गुरु दीनतारिणं परमानंद माधवं श्रीचैतन्यं ईश्वरं। नमाओं विष्णु पदाय कृष्ण प्रेष्ठाय भूतले श्रीमते भक्ति वेदांत स्वामिनिति नामिने। नमस्ते सरस्वते देवे गौरवाणी प्रचारिणे निर्विशेषा शून्यवादी पाश्चात्य देश तारिणे वांछा कल्पतरूभ्यश्च कृपा सिंधुभ्य एव च पतितानां पावनेभ्यो वैष्णवेभ्यो नमो नमः। जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैता गदाधर शिवासादि गौर भक्त वृंद। हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे हरे, हरे राम 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 हरे हरे। हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे हरे, हरे राम 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 हरे हरे। हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे हरे, हरे राम 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 हरे हरे। हरे कृष्णा। सो दिस इज अ वेरी वेरी इंटेंस सेक्शन इन द श्रीमद् भागवतम विच वी आर रीडिंग। द 8th चैप्टर ऑफ 5th कैंटो महाराज बरस पर्सनालिटी इज डिस्क्राइब्ड, हिज फॉल डाउन इज डिस्क्राइब्ड। And I had written an article on this sometime back for the Back to Godhead magazine, where, you know, we had analyzed his entire pastime. And if you see, Bharat Maharaj went through 4 things after he got distracted by the deer. Helping the deer was not a problem, but the 4 things he did actually led to his fall down. First was, he reduced the standard of his devotional service. Saving the deer, he could have continued his bhakti, but he reduced the standard. He was not performing his daily spiritual activity the way he was performing before the deer entered his life. Now, reducing was still okay. Sometimes we slip, sometimes we are unable to maintain the high standards, so we reduce. But the second biggest problem was, Bharat Maharaj started reasoning. He started justifying his reducing the standards. And this is where all the problems begin. Many times, devotees are unable to follow certain practices, but instead of being humble and saying, yes, I'm struggling, I want to improve. But instead of that, what do? We say, no, this is the way Prabhupada actually meant like this. You know, we should be doing like this. And we start justifying our lower standard. And that attitude is actually very dangerous, because once we start justifying and we start defying the parampara and Srila Prabhupada, then the third R enters our life, and that is ritual. Whatever we are doing, bhakti, then it becomes a ritual. There is no feelings of, there is no love and emotions for the Lord. So first it begins with the reducing the standards. Then that is still okay, because we can come back on track. But once we start reasoning or drifting away as proper, then the third thing happens, which is bhakti practices become dry, mechanical, and they become ritualistic. And Bharat Maharaj, for example, you know, he was chanting. But when the deer would come and pet him, and, you know, he would start putting his body on his body, and then he would start rubbing, and sometimes he would pretend to be meditating. So when the deer would come, he would pretend as if he is meditating, but in the corner of his eye, he would look at the deer, and the deer would come and brush itself against his body, but he would pretend as if he is not interested. But his heart would be with the deer. So externally he is chanting. Remember, externally he is doing all his bhakti. But internally he is enjoying the company with the deer. Like, you know, we may be chanting and we may also be checking our WhatsApp messages on the left hand. So that's something, that's our deer. You know, we all have a deer. So what happens is, so then Bharat Maharaj started doing it all like a ritual. And he was also reasoning. He started, there are verses which says that Bharat Maharaj started saying, oh, people may think what I'm doing is not correct, but they do not know this is what I'm doing is very right. You know, I may have reduced my standard. This is not reduction. This is actually, I'm doing proper service. So all that justification that happens in the brain, happens in the mind. That removes the taste in bhakti. That removes the rasa in bhakti, because our attitude is that I am right. I know what I want. This is Maya. Maya means the attitude that I am the boss, I am controller, I know what is right for me. So then, because of that, the taste of, you know, that desire to take shelter of Krishna, that goes away. And when that goes away, then all our practices become dry ritual. And then the fourth thing happens, the fourth R. Bharat Maharaj was practicing his bhakti, he was practicing all those things, but not only was it dry and ritualistic, but he became restless. He couldn't continue the practice. So this is what happens with us also. If we reduce our standards, and if worst thing is if you start justifying the reduction of the standards rather than be humble about it, then our practices become ritualistic, devoid of any emotion. And then we become restless in the practices of bhakti, and we would rather watch Netflix. We would rather do some other materialistic activities, because we are not happy in the process of Krishna consciousness. And the most dangerous of these four R's is the second one, when we start reasoning and justifying. Because, you know, there are some people who have really struggled with four regulative principles. And what has happened with them is, Krishna has been very kind to them. Krishna has helped them come back on track. Krishna has, especially in their last moments, Krishna has helped them remember Krishna, although they had apparently deviated. You'll have to excuse me. I just, there's some sound coming. I need to stop the sound. Just excuse me. Hare Krishna, I'm sorry. There was a lot of construction work going on outside, and because of that, a lot of sound. So I had to stop the construction work. I'm sorry. I'm back. So I was talking about something, and I don't know where I was. Would somebody like to unmute and explain where I was so that we can come back on track? Yes, Shreyas, Shyam Sakapru, I can see you. You'll have to unmute. Achha, the admin has to unmute, is it?
Yeah. Hare Krishna, Prabhuji. Prabhuji, you were explaining about some devotees really struggled with the regulative principles, but still Krishna helped them remember Krishna at the last moment of their life.
Yeah, they got association of devotees. They came back to proper practices. Thank you, Shamsaka Prabhu. And Krishna helped them because their attitude was right. You know, they were not justifying. Sometimes what happens is we may strictly follow the rules and we may slip a little, and instead of coming back on track or being humble about it, we start reasoning, oh, I'm right. You know, actually Prabhupada meant like this. Actually, you know, it's impractical. What we are doing is right. This is very, very dangerous and unhealthy. So, you know, there was one lecture I was hearing about from Srila Prabhupada. It was a coincidence. One Grihastha couple were saying that they were struggling with all the rules that Srila Prabhupada gave. And then, you know, I said, I'm a brahmachari. You know, I can't really advise you on this. But they said, what do you think from a Shastra point of view? You know, Prabhupada gave strict standards. You know, he said, if you don't follow this, then we're in Maya. So then I was saying that, you know, nobody in Kali Yuga, unless you're a pure devotee, can strictly follow everything that the scriptures have said. But, you know, the Vedic society is based on Varnashram. In Varnashram, there is a system where there is a place for sense gratification also. So then I was quoting Srila Prabhupada's lecture, which Srila Prabhupada gave in Bombay in October 1973, where he was saying that sometimes devotees cannot give up sense gratification. So Srila Prabhupada, I mean, I was so amazed to hear this class, because Srila Prabhupada, like a loving father or grandfather, he's telling the devotees, don't lose hope. He's saying that, okay, you can't give up enjoying, then at least go to Krishna and take permission from him before enjoying. So Srila Prabhupada is saying, take permission from Krishna. And then in that lecture, what Srila Prabhupada said is something very nice. He said, when he was a young boy, when he was 3 years old, whenever he had to go to the bathroom, to washroom, he would catch his mother and he would pull her. And he would tell her, mommy, mommy, I want to go to the bathroom. So his mother would say, go, who is stopping you? Why do you have to take permission like that? So then Srila Prabhupada gives his example and says, it is the nature of a conditioned soul who's like a child to take permission from the Lord. It is our natural, it is there in the part of the soul. So then Srila Prabhupada urged the devotees that why don't you take permission from Krishna? Like I was hearing another class today morning. This is also October, but 1972, named Vrindavan, this is the lecture. And this is on the first canto verse where Prabhupada, where Sutta Goswami is saying, Kamasya Nendriya Pritir, where you know that even if you enjoy sense gratification, that should not be for our own enjoyment. It should be as a part of, you know, something that has to be done so that we can grow in our spiritual life. So there also Prabhupada says, we cannot give up eating, sleeping, mating, defending. That is okay. But at least don't forget Tattvam Asi. Don't forget the goal of life. Don't forget that Atato Brahma Jigyasa. Don't forget that ultimately we have to go back to Krishna. So be focused on the goal. That is what Srila Prabhupada is saying. Sometimes devotees will fall down, which is unfortunate. It shouldn't happen. But don't allow this fall down to become fall down to lead to fall away. You know, there is a difference between fall down and fall away from Krishna consciousness. Fall down in Krishna consciousness, you can still come back. But if you fall away, then you can't come back. So, you know, it's like devotees, we need to bounce back even if we slip. So Bharat Maharaj reduced his standards. There was a distraction. So we also may get distracted thanks to modern times. There are so many agents of Maya everywhere. But some of the most important thing we can learn from this pastime is let us not reason and justify our lower standards in bhakti. Like, you know, for example, in Kunti's section, we find this beautiful verse where Kunti Devi is saying, oh Krishna, how can I know you? Katam pashyema hi striya. I am after all, I'm an ordinary woman. I can't understand you. And ironically, just before this, paradoxically rather, before this verse, she has revealed who is Krishna. She said, Krishna, nobody can understand you. Maya, javani kachannam, you are an expert actor and only pure devotees can know you. Such profound wisdom she has revealed. But in the end, she says, but how can I see you? You know, I'm after all an ordinary person. So Prabhupada writes there that she's actually the most qualified. But look at her attitude. That it's that attitude that will help us fight back, bounce back when we're attacked by Maya. Attitude that I'm small, I'm a servant, and yes, Maya is powerful. And I'm not justifying my lower standard because we're all fallible. And Krishna and Maya will prove to us again and again that we are ordinary and we are fallible. But let us not fight against Maya as if we are the greatest. Let us take shelter of Krishna. That is very important. You know? So, see, we have this attitude that I'm ordinary, you know, like Kunti Devi is teaching. Then even if we struggle with our standards, we can come back because our attitude is in the right place. This is very, very important. You know, like if you see about Maya, how we are all gripped by Maya. Prahlad Maharaj, he explains this beautifully in the seventh canto. Now, don't get offended, but Prahlad Maharaj is speaking the harsh reality. So when a devotee hears this, he hears with an open heart, with a humble heart. Otherwise, we'll get offended. Shukdev Goswami is chastising so many times. In the Bhagavatam, he calls us as fools, asses, camels. We have to know that this is to keep us humble, yes. But this doesn't mean that, okay, I am so bad, you know, now I can't do bhakti at all. No, we will do bhakti. We have an aspiration to follow the highest standards. And if we slip, God forbid, it shouldn't happen. But if that happens, we come back. We don't justify what we have done. So Prahlad Maharaj reveals the psychology of a materialistic person. He says in the seventh canto, when he's instructing his classmates, he says, how we get gripped by Maya? Katam priyaya anukampitaya sangam rahasyam ruchiram shamantran suhur sutat sneha shita shishunam kalaksharanam anurakta chitta. He says, a man is thinking, oh, where is my beautiful girlfriend? Katam priyaya. Oh, when will she be merciful to me? Anukampitaya. And katam priyaya anukampitaya. And what will she do with me? Sangam, Rahasyam. She will give me association in a solitary place. And what will we do there in that solitary place? Ruchiram Sha Mantran. In my ears, she will whisper soft mantras, not Hare Krishna mantra. She will whisper something else. So Prahlad is saying that she will, and the man is thinking she will whisper the sweet things in my ears. And then what will happen? Suhur Sutat Sneha Shita Shishunam. Then he'll get attached to her. Then they'll get married. Then they'll have children. And once they have children, he'll get attached to the children. And then when the children are born, Kalakshara Manurakta Chitta. The broken words of the child will fascinate everyone. And that man will be completely, completely mesmerized by the broken words of the child. And then is Maya will continue. How? Putran smaramsha duhirte rudaya bratur sasurva pitarau chadino grihan manogno rupari chadamsha vrittish chakulya pashu vrittya vargan. Then you start thinking, oh, my son, is he studying properly? My daughter is married and gone away, but is she all right in her in-laws, in her husband's place? Who? How is my brother doing? How are my parents doing? How, you know, he's always thinking, and it comes to such an extent that Grihan Manognoru Parichadam even gets attached to the furniture of his house. Prahlad Maharaj says our attachments become so deep rooted that he starts thinking, oh, my furniture, this is my sofa. And we get attached to laptops, our bed, our, you know, everything. And then this comes as the most important verse. Then describing the psychology of our attachment and trapped by Maya, Prahlad says, Tajeta koshas kridivehamanam karmani lobhada vitruttakama aupastya jayvam bahumanyamanam katam virajeta duranta moha. He says, how will katam virajeta, how will a man get out of maya duranta moha? Because he has become like a silkworm which weaves a cocoon, but it itself gets trapped in that. Similarly, karmani lobhada, we work hard for happiness, but that work, instead of liberating us from cycle of birth and death, that work entangles us more, and avitripta kama, and our desires are also not satisfied. It's a lose-lose. And why all this is happening? Because we want to satisfy aupastya jayvam bahumanyamana. We want to satisfy the tongue and genitals. Oh, katam virajeta, how will a man get out of this maya? So you see, very strong, right? These verses are very strong, but they are so accurately describing our trap of Maya. So once I was giving a class on these verses, and there was an elderly lady, she was in the class, and after the class, she raised her hand and she said, Prabhuji, I have a question. And she said, Prabhuji, I'm so fallen. You know, you were speaking about how we are all trapped by Maya, how Maya is so powerful. And, you know, I am also like that. I don't think I'll ever go back to Krishna. You know, I'm so far away from Krishna. I have no love for Krishna. So like that, she was speaking and I heard her for a few minutes. I said, Mataji, what? How exactly are you in Maya? She said, I'm so attached to my family. You know, Prahlad is saying this is all Maya. And, you know, what will happen? You know, I'll never go back to Krishna. I said, wait. I said, what do you mean, Mataji? I mean, what exactly do you do? You're attached to your family. She said, I'm a grandmother. I said, how many grandchildren do you have? She said, I have 9 grandchildren. And, you know, I've got 4 children and 2 sons, 2 daughters, and I've got totally 9 grandchildren. And I spend a lot of time with them. I said, what do you do with them? I tell them stories from Ramayana and Mahabharata. Every day I talk to all my 9 grandchildren. I spend my whole day like this. So therefore, I'm very attached to my family. So I can't go back to Krishna. So I heard her patiently. And then I told her, Mataji, great. The way you are speaking, the attitude you are having, the mood you are having, this is excellent. Continue to feel like this. But, don't stop giving affection to your grandchildren. Continue everything the way it is. But add more Krishna consciousness and be humble like this, because you are doing a great service. You are giving your grandchildren Krishna consciousness. And when children get love from their grandparents, when they grow up, they will be so grateful to you. You are contributing to the society. You know, it's not that only the Nobel laureate scientists are contributing to human society. You are also contributing. And then I told her how I grew up with my grandparents in my first 10 years of life. And because they gave me so much love, I still am able to continue in life, you know, with sanity. So grandparents' love, grandparents' blessings is so important, and you are doing such great service. But the mood which you are having, internal mood, you're not justifying it. You're not saying that, yes, you know, what can I do? I'm a grandmother. I have to give love. And this is all not for us. These Bhagavatam verses are for somebody else. No. These Bhagavatam verses are for us. And we are in Maya. I want to improve. This attitude is what helps us come out of Maya. This is what will keep us on track. Because Maya is very powerful. We can't win over Maya simply by learning shlokas. Okay. Just because I know how Maya traps us, doesn't mean I am free from Maya. But of course, there are three principles that we can learn. You know, that like the 4 hours is the 4 hours of fall down. But now we need a solution. We need how we can save ourselves from Maya. That is, I think, all of us would want to know. So there are 3 A's. The first is alertness. We have to be alert. There has to be awareness always in our spiritual practices. It is this awareness and alertness which helps us. Like Srila Prabhupada, he explains this very beautifully in the first canto of Bhagavatam, where, you know, Shukdev Goswami, his arrival is described. Now, Shaunakadi rishis are asking questions on Shukdev Goswami. So they say, please tell us about Shukdev Goswami. So when they ask this question, Srila Prabhupada writes in the first line of that purport. This is the first canto, 4th chapter. I don't remember the verse. So the first line of purport, Srila Prabhupada writes, Shukdev Goswami was a liberated soul and therefore he was always alert of getting entangled by the material energy. He was alert of Maya. Very interesting. Shukdev Goswami was a liberated soul. So generally we think if somebody is liberated soul, he doesn't have to be alert. But if Shukdev Goswami is a liberated soul, and he is alert about Maya, just imagine how much more alert we have to be. We are not like Shukdev Goswami. Shukdev Goswami did not want to come out of the womb of his mother because he was afraid of Maya. He was so alert. For 16 years, he did not come out. Then his father said, Arek, please come out. Why are you torturing us? So your mother and me are very frustrated. Please come out of the womb. He said, no, I cannot come. Maya is very strong. So then Vyasadeva said, I am assuring you nothing will happen. Come out. So he said, who will take your assurance? You just now told that you are frustrated. That means you are in duality. Sometimes you are happy. Sometimes you are sad. So if you are in duality, how can you protect me from Maya? But then Vyasadeva said, then how can I give you assurance that you will not be affected by Maya? Shukdev Goswami said that you get me that person who is a controller of Maya. If he tells me that I will not be affected by Maya, then I will come. Then Vyasadeva went to Dwarka, requested Krishna. Krishna came and Krishna assured Shukdev Goswami. Then Shukdev Goswami came out of the womb. So look at his alertness. And he's a liberated soul. He's so alert. How much more alert we have to be? See, there are a few things. You know, like, you know, in a war, an army soldier, when they are trained, they need 3 things to fight against the enemy. First is they need knowledge of the weapons. They need to have knowledge, okay. You know, which are the weapons? Okay, this is a bomb, this is a gun. They need a knowledge of their weapons. But simply knowledge is not sufficient. They need training also. They need to know how to use the gun. I mean, if somebody has not practiced, somebody is not trained, then the knowledge is useless. But knowledge and training is not sufficient. He needs a 3rd thing. That is, he has to be alert also. Imagine he has a bomb, a gun, he has the bomb, everything he has, but he's sleeping. But the enemy will come and kill him. All 3 are needed, right? Like some years back, some border security force soldiers, they had all the knowledge of the weapons. They had the training also, but they were not alert. So this terrorist attack, and they were caught off guard and they were killed. So we may have knowledge, we may have training, but we also need to be alert. Similarly, in spiritual life, we have the knowledge. We know that 64 items of devotional service are there. This will help us practice bhakti nicely. Very good. We also have training. So you come to ISKCON temple, you get training in deity worship. And we also have seminars. These classes are all part of training sessions where we learn how to listen to Krishna, consciousness lectures, how to chant Hare Krishna. We have holy name seminars. All these things is part of training. So we have knowledge and we have training. But this is not sufficient. We also have to be alert. We have to be aware. So this awareness and alertness is the first A. There are 3 A's which will help us handle Maya. and cope with Maya's attacks consistently in our lives. First is constant practice of awareness and alertness. You know, in that famous section in the Bhagavatam where Vyasadev is getting vision of the Bhagavatam, it is mentioned, Bhakti Yogena Manasi Samyak Pranite Male Apashyat Purusham Puranam Mayam Chata Tapashrayam. Vyasadev actually saw in his vision, he saw both Krishna and Maya. Means there is awareness. Sometimes we say, oh, I love Krishna. But we have to be aware of Maya also. Like once one devotee went and told Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur, Prabhupada, I saw Krishna in the dream. Oh, such a beautiful dream. Whole night I was with Krishna dancing. So Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur said, oh, you saw Krishna in the dream. Did you also see Maya in the dream? He said, no Maya, only Krishna. Then Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur said, then that dream is bogus. He said, there has to be awareness of Maya. At our stage, we cannot artificially say, I'm only Krishna conscious. No, we have to be alert. And therefore, it is important that, therefore, what happened? What did Vyasadev do? Because of his awareness, what happened? Yaya sammo hito jivo atmanam trigunatmakam paropi manute nartam tatkutam chapi padyate. So Vyasadev, because of his awareness, he saw Krishna, he saw Maya, and then he saw Yaya Sammohito Jivo Atmanam Trigunatmi. He saw that the soul is transcendental to Maya, but Paropi Manute Nartam Tatkritam Chabipadyate. But still, he was under the control of Maya. So, Krishna is here, Maya is here, and the soul, who is actually supposed to be part of Krishna's internal energy, is also controlled by Maya. So, Krishna, Maya, and living entity. So, therefore, he wrote, Srimad Bhagavatam Anartho Pashamam Sakshad Bhakti Yoga Madokshaje Lokasya Janato Vidvam Chakre Satvata Samhitam. He gave us this beautiful Srimad Bhagavatam. And when we take shelter of Srimad Bhagavatam, when we have this awareness and alertness, this is the first step in handling Maya. The second is, all along with awareness, we also need good association. Bharat Maharaj did not have association. You know, if you had good association, devotees would have told him, Prabhu, Bharat Prabhu, you are in Maya. You are spending too much time with your iPhone. Please chant Hare Krishna. You are spending too much time on WhatsApp. You are 6 hours on Facebook today, Prabhu, Bharat Prabhu. So, just like Bharat Maharaj got trapped by a deer, all of us have our own deer. Right? We all have a deer. And that, if you have good association, they will tell us. They will guide us. Like when Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was going on a South India Yatra, he had taken his servant Kala Krishna Das with him. And Kala Krishna Das got so distracted. He was with Lord Chaitanya, the Supreme Lord. He was a servant of Supreme Lord. But he got distracted by beautiful women, Bhattahari women who offered him wealth and all of that. And beautiful women this community offered him, and he got carried away. Lord Chaitanya dragged him by the shika and brought him back. And then after coming to Puri, he handed him over to the devotee and said, I have nothing to do with him. He left me. So Srila Prabhupada writes there, the Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, the Kaviraj Goswami says, Stridana Dekhana Tandra Lobhajan Mila. Stridana Dekhana. He saw stri and women and wealth. When he saw women and wealth, there are three W's. WWW dot. Wealth, women and worship. Wealth, women and worship. Women means men for women, basically opposite sex. www.com. Kam means lust. So www.com is our attack of Maya. So he got attracted. Kala Krishna got attracted by wealth and women. Stridana Dekhana Tanra Lobhajan Neela. He got distracted. Arya Sarala Viprera Buddhina Shakpaila. He was Arya. He was a civilized man. He was Sarala. He was a simple person. Viprera. He was very clean and Brahminical. But still, what happened? Arya Sarala Viprera Buddhi Nasha Koila. His intelligence got contaminated. Srila Prabhupada writes in the purport there that Kala Krishna Das was with the Supreme Personality of Godhead and he got distracted by Maya. What to speak of you and me? Prabhupada says, we are ordinary. And we don't have to go to Maya. Maya has come to our pocket. You know, she has come in the form of such an attractive gadget. So association is important. So when Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu rejected Kala Krishna Das, Kala Krishna Das was crying. He was begging for help. And Lord Chaitanya said, no, I don't want to see him. I don't want to see him. He felt so shattered. But the devotees came to his rescue. Nityananda, Jagadananda, Mukunda, Damodar. Nityananda Prabhu, Jagadananda Prabhu, Mukunda, Dutt and Damodar Pandit. What did they do? Nityananda, Jagadananda, Mukunda, Damodar, Chari Jane, Yukti Tabe, Kurila Antar. They had a meeting how to help Kala Krishna Das. Then they said, we will send him to Navadvip. Mother Sachi is worried. Is there, Mother Sachi is worried. What is happening to my son? How is he? Has he come back from South India? So let Kala Krishna Das go to Navadvip and let him tell all of them about Lord Chaitanya's South India travel. So they will all be happy. So then all these four devotees, they packed a lot of prasad, they gave to Kala Krishna Das, and they went to Lord Chaitanya and said, Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, you have rejected Kala Krishna Das, but we are thinking of giving them this very special service of sending him to Bengal and telling Mother Sachi and Advaita Acharya and everybody about your South India travels. Lord Chaitanya smiled. He didn't smile. He didn't say anything. He just said, do what you think is right. Means Lord Chaitanya was happy that he had taken shelter of devotees. So then Kala Krishna Das went to Navadvip and devotees are so happy. And Advaita Acharya said, oh, you know, when they all heard about Lord Chaitanya's pastime, they all came together. They had a 3-day festival of hearing, chanting. And there was big Vaishnava festival. Devotees came together and all these festivals happened because of Kala Krishna Das. So a person who fell down to Maya was even rejected by the Supreme Lord. Still, he was instrumental in creating such great Vaishnava festivals because he took shelter of association of devotees. So this is very, very important. Association of devotees is the second most important principle to handle, cope with Maya. And third is, what is our aspiration? We may have the best association. We may be very alert. But if you don't have a higher goal, if you don't have an aspiration, then what will you do with that alertness and association? We have to somehow have an aspiration that Krishna, I want you. I want to love you, Krishna. I don't want to love Maya. I want to give up entanglement with material energy, Krishna. I'm yours. My life is for you. When we have that aspiration, along with our alertness and association, then we are safe. This is an equilateral triangle. All three are important. So Gajendra teaches us how to have the right aspiration. He was totally entangled. But Gajendra, what intensely he prays. He says, Namami megya taya turangaja kuta karinya prabhavanti mochitum graena pashena vidhaturavruto peham chattamyami paramparayanam. He says, oh, my dear Lord, I'm now realizing, where is my wife? Where are my children? Where is my family? Nobody is able to help me. Kuta karinya, because this noose with the crocodile has bound me with. Grahena pashena, this is actually vidhata. This is my destiny. This is what I'm not blaming the crocodile. Peham chatam yami paramparayanam. Oh, Krishna, I surrender to you. So please save me, Krishna. Srila Prabhupada in today's purport also writes about how this is like a venomous snake. So even Gajendra in that mood, he prays, Yakaschanesho balinontako ragat prachanda vegat abhidavato prishan bhitam prapannam pratipati advayan mrityo pradavat aranam tamimahi. He says, we are running away from Maya. He says, Maya is like a huge python which is chasing us. Yakaschanesho balinontako ragat prachanda vegat. And she's about to devour us. But at that moment, if you take shelter of Krishna, then what will happen? Bhitam prapannam pratipati yadbhayan. Then Maya will turn away. The snake will turn away and Krishna will chase the snake. And the snake will run away from us. Mrityu pradhavat aranam tamimahi. We are chased by Mrityu. But when we take shelter of Krishna, then Mrityu runs away from Krishna. So then, basically, our aspiration is, Krishna, I am yours. Krishna, I surrender to you. Only then we can be safe in bhakti. Till we surrender, Maya will always... Surrender is not an external activity. Not that I increase my rounds. We have to increase our round. That's okay. But that is not surrender. Surrender is offering of our heart and telling Krishna, Krishna, I am a puppet in your hands. take charge of my life. I belong to you. I want to execute your will. See, there are three things. First step is, you know, when before coming to KC, before coming to Krishna consciousness, we are dragged by the mind. Mind takes us everywhere. Like imagine you are in a chariot where the horses take you wherever they want to take. You are suffering, tossed. So then we come to the second stage, that is Krishna consciousness. We say, hey, wait. The horses, how dare they take me everywhere? I take control of the chariot. This is my chariot of my life. But then we are now in control, right? This is the Krishna conscious practice is what we are doing. But Krishna wants us to come to the third stage where we are trying to control the horses and we realize I can't actually control it. And we say, Krishna, I give up. Krishna, you have to take charge of my chariot of my life. And then Krishna takes charge. So the third stage and the first stage, they appear similar, right? In the first stage also, I'm not doing anything, but mind is dragging me. Maya is dragging me. In the third stage also, I'm not doing, but Krishna is taking charge. It looks very similar. That's why many times in our premature stage of bhakti, we may think, oh, I'm a devotee, Krishna, I'm doing whatever Krishna is telling, but actually the mind is dragging. Therefore, we have to become Goswami. Prabhupada said, we have to control our senses, we have to fight, we have to struggle. But as we do that, over a period of time, we realize, as we advance in bhakti, as we spend 2 or 3 decades, that Maya never leaves. Maya is always there. So then what do? Krishna, I've been so much chanting, so many things, but Maya is constantly harassing me. Krishna, I am yours. Krishna, I surrender to you. Then Krishna will take our bhakti seriously. Srila Prabhupada writes in teachings of Queen Kunti, these are the lectures Srila Prabhupada gave in Los Angeles on Kunti Mayani's prayers. So there Srila Prabhupada writes a very beautiful statement that why does Maya trouble devotees so much? Because Maya wants to see whether we want to serve Krishna or whether we want to disturb Krishna. Now we can never disturb Krishna. Krishna will never be disturbed by us, but our mood, Maya Devi will thoroughly test us. Are we going to really serve Krishna or do we have an attitude? Are we going to disturb Krishna? So therefore Maya will not leave us. Therefore Krishna says in the Gita, Devi Esha Gunamai Mama Maya Duratya. He says my Maya is very powerful to overcome. She cannot be overcome. Look at the choice of words. Krishna says Mama Maya Duratya. My Maya is difficult to overcome. My Maya, Krishna, if Krishna had said Maya is difficult to overcome, we would have thought Maya is some ordinary thing which I can overcome. No, Krishna says, my Maya, you cannot overcome it. I am there. I am the one who's triggered this. So we may, if Krishna had only said Mama Maya, we would have said, oh, it is Krishna's. Krishna is so cute. Krishna is so nice. So his Maya also is nice. So Krishna says, no, Mama Maya, Duratyaya. It is very, very difficult, very harsh. So Krishna has used both words for Maya, this verse. Mama Maya Duratyaya. Mama means my Maya and also very, very cruel. She will harass us. Both. You know, it's like there was a thief. He wanted to steal money from a rich man's house. So a friend came and told him, you know what? I'll tell you a secret. Go to that rich man's house in the midnight at 12:15. If you go at 12:15, there will be nobody at home and you can steal all the money. So the thief said, thank you, my dear friend. You are so good to me. And then that friend quietly went to the owner of the house and told him that today at 12:15 in the night, this thief is going to come. Be ready. So what do you think that will happen to that thief? He will be caught, right? So Krishna is like that friend. Krishna tells us, practice bhakti. You can go back to Godhead. Hari Bol. So we are very excited. Oh, Krishna has opened the lock of the material world. We are going to go. And then Krishna goes and tells Maya, hey, he's trying to go. Huh? Take care of him. Test him. Test him thoroughly. He's planning to get out of material world. So Krishna and Maya Devi, they are hands in gloves. They want us to thoroughly purify us completely so that we go back to Krishna with the full desire that Krishna, I try to control everything. I try to be in charge of my spiritual life, but I realize Krishna, I surrender to you. I am not in control. So this is the right aspiration. So if this also is in the right place, if this is also in place, if all three are there, if you are alert, if you have association and if you have aspiration, And then we have a chance. Despite our slips and struggles, we can go back to Krishna in this one lifetime. So to summarize, we can take some questions now. To summarize, I spoke about the 4 R's of a fall down, reducing our standards, reasoning, and then the bhakti practices become ritualistic, and then we become restless. And there I spoke about reasoning as a very, very important thing, because we spoke about how that attitude of justifying our lower standards is what gets us. And I was talking about October 1973 lecture of Prabhupada and 1972 lecture of Prabhupada in Bombay, Vrindavan, where Prabhupada is saying we have to take permission from Krishna even if we want to engage in sense gratification. Like Srila Prabhupada giving his own example. And also Prabhupada says, even if you engage in sense gratification, don't forget the goal of life. You know, just be focused on Krishna and keep coming back. And then we discuss how fall down is different from falling away from Krishna. And we can learn from the pastime of Bharat Maharaj the 3 A's of spiritual practices, which is awareness or alertness, which we can learn from the example of Vyasadeva seeing Maya and Krishna. And also we discussed the second A, which is the association from the Kala Krishnadas pastime. And also the third A was aspiration, like Gajendra's prayers, which reveal that, you know, I was earlier dragged by Maya, then I tried to control the chariot of my life, but now I give up and I allow Krishna to take charge of my life. So then when we do that, we can come back to Krishna. We can handle this material energy and all the sufferings that we have to go through, and then come back to Krishna happily after the end of his lifetime. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna. So now we can have some questions and comments.
Thank you so much, Prabhu, for enlightening us on this topic, especially about these 3, 4 R's of how we fall down, and the reasoning being important, and 3 R's of alertness and awareness, association and aspiration, and beautiful, beautiful examples, Prabhu, which is even day life, we can think those and follow in those directions. Thank you so much for enlightening class, Prabhu. So grateful, Prabhu. Devotees, anybody would like to ask questions, can you please raise hands, and maybe you can have this. Anybody would like to ask any questions, please raise hands.
Hare Krishna Prabhuji, Dhanavad Pranam, such a beautiful, beautiful class, Prabhu, very nice examples, very nicely said, Prabhu, but always we start reasoning, somehow the reasoning comes into the mind, and as you said, we try to, you know, tell that, okay, today I'm not feeling well, or, you know, that's fine, okay, today one day, so how do we, you know, how do we stop seeing that, and how do I judge, okay, this is the reasoning that I'm giving is okay and this is not okay, this is going to make me fall down, how do I judge?
Actually, okay, basically you are saying, how do I know whether what I'm doing is Maya or it is not Maya?
Yes, Prabhuji.
Because Maya is so expert, Maya will come in the guise of a friend. Sometimes the mind will tell us, "Arey, it is okay, you can watch this movie." So then you watch that movie, then you're miserable. You can't enjoy that movie also. And then after watching the movie, you think you're in Maya. So either way, you're miserable. So, and then you think, but do this, I could have used this for Krishna service. So basically, there's a simple test. You can know whether what you are doing or what you have done is Maya or not Maya. And the test is, see, I'll tell you an example. Once, you know, I and a few devotees, we were sitting together, and we were discussing about helping some other devotee who had done some mistakes. But in the mood of helping and discussing, we actually started talking a lot about his faults. And at some point of time, I realized it's not correct. We are doing fault finding. But no, we are helping him. No, this is important to us to know. So there was some kind of, I was actually enjoying that maybe. So then what happened? That meeting got over. Then I sat in my room. I saw myself put my feet on the table, and some devotees had some kind of party. They had some things which I generally don't drink, like, and there was Sprite, and we were laughing, and the whole attitude, you know, I had an attitude of enjoyer, and I had like it led my it that entire discussion. After that discussion, I was in the mood of enjoying, controlling. Now, if I was genuinely in the mood of helping that devotee, then after the meeting, I would have been in a mood of service. I would have preferred to read about Krishna. I would have done something, service to somebody. So the test is whether that, how does that activity end in? Does that activity end in service or does that activity end in sense gratification? Sometimes, you know, we need a painkiller. You know, sometimes, see, medicine is Krishna consciousness. But as you're taking the medicine of Krishna consciousness, devotees go through suffering, they feel a need for a painkiller because painkiller gives instant relief. But painkiller, only if you take only painkiller, then our life will be disastrous. If somebody has a chest pain and he only takes painkillers, eventually there will be a time in his life when he, even if he takes one dozen painkillers, this pain won't go. Painkiller is not a substitute for medicine. But sometimes there is a need for painkiller. If the dog is barking too much, sometimes you have to feed the dog to shut him up, you know. So sometimes the need, that's why the Varnashram system is made, where there is a place for sense gratification. So you can know whether you're in Maya or not if your overall attitude, if you have a sadhana card and if your overall attitude is of service, overall attitude is of serving, and you know, you will know the difference. You know, if you are engaging in Maya, then you will may at best experience pleasure. But when we engage in service of Krishna, we experience satisfaction. There is a difference between pleasure and satisfaction. Pleasure is the titillation of the senses. Maya will only give us titillation of the senses, but Krishna will give us deep, enduring satisfaction of the heart. So you you can know that, you know, from through trial and error. That is the way you can know whether what you're doing is Maya or not. Is that okay, Mataji? Hare Krishna.
Yes, Prabhuji, thank you so much for the detailed explanation and with the situation. Thank you so much, Prabhu. Thank you, Hare Krishna. Devotees, one more time, please raise your hand if you have any question.
Yes, Shraddha Mataji, I can see. And then Padma Priya Mataji. Yes. And then Shraddha, Vrinda Gopika Mataji after that. Yes. Shraddha Mataji, Hare Krishna.
Shraddha Mataji, please go ahead, Mataji. I am unmute. Can you unmute, Mataji?
Hare Krishna.
Yes, please.
Hare Krishna, Danda Pranam Prabhu. Can you hear me?
Yeah, please.
Audible.
I can't hear you now. So, what do we do?
Reboot.
I can't hear you. Yeah. Again, you have muted yourself, so I can't
Mataji,
hear you.
Mataji, don't mute yourself.
Or we can take a question, just come on chat, or maybe somebody else.
Okay,
now you're unmuted. Yeah, please.
Sorry for the technical.
Yeah, please. Please start.
Prabhuji, so I have a question. Danda Pranam. I have a question. Like, so basically what I wanted to understand is, I've heard this somewhere that usually when a person goes through a fall down, that one of the main reason behind it is that the person has offended somebody, like some devotees. So I just wanted to understand, supposedly you gave 4 hours, that was wonderful, but supposedly during that phase when the person has gone through that fall down, that time that he was away from the devotional, he or she was away from the devotional service and away from the association, and in that phase when the person was in the material realm, again he or she must have offended somebody or committed some offenses. So that is like, how do the person come out of that vicious cycle of again not offending devotees? And
see, this is
I don't know if I made any sense.
Yeah, offenses, you are saying, could offenses be the cause of fall down? Yes, ultimately everything is offense only, because the root of all offenses is inattention. So when we are inattentive either with the holy name, or we are inattentive in our practices, or we are inattentive in our dealings with other devotees, so ultimately all offenses spring from not being attentive. So that is one of the topics we discussed today, right? Alertness, awareness. So yes, offensive. So, and we can overcome that tendency by continuing to come back to practice alertness, association, and aspiration. So offenses, you know, we can't be obsessed with offenses like, oh, I'm offending. Oh, did I offend today? See, we can't be offense conscious. We have to be Krishna conscious. So sometimes we can't avoid certain offenses, but we need to have a healthy attitude of wanting to overcome. See, if you see the Bhaktivinoda Thakur's, we chant those 10 offenses to the holy name. Then what do we say? What is the 10th offense? To maintain material attachments. Remember that? The 10th one? To maintain material attachment despite, what is the 10th offense? To not have complete faith in the chanting of the holy name and to maintain material attachments even after hearing so many instructions on this matter. So it does not say it's an offense to have material attachment. It says to maintain material attachments. Means that attitude, the desire to remove those offenses should be there. If I have an attitude of maintaining them, if I'm having an attitude that, okay, I'm good, that is what is bad. So I think that's the way we can handle our offenses also. Okay, Mataji, thank you. So now we can take Padma Prema Mataji, then Vrinda Gopika Mataji, and then Sai Vivek. Is the next. Yes, Mataji. Padma Priya Mataji.
Hare Krishna Prabhuji. Dandavat Pranam. Thank you for the very beautiful class, Prabhuji. So my question was, Bharat Maharaj, he left his old kingdom and everything. He got detached from his family and he went to forest and he started meditating. So his desire was to go back to Krishna and he left the whole attachment, you know, the big kingdom. But how he was meditating on Krishna, all of a sudden he got attached to a deer. So is this a test from Krishna or it just happened? That was my first question. Another question is, when he left everything, the big kingdom family, then how easily he got attached to a small deer? And at the time of his death, Krishna is so merciful, even though, you know, they have practiced so much and they fall down for a few times also. He makes them to remember at the time of death. But he was practicing the whole life. Why he was not able to remember Krishna at the time of his death? He was remembering deer.
See, Bharat Maharaj's pastime is mentioned in the Srimad Bhagavatam, and Bharat Maharaj is not an ordinary personality. This is the Lord's arrangement. This is the Lord's pastime for us to understand and learn from our mistakes. Because one who is in the bhava stage can never fall down. And Bharat Maharaj is in the bhava stage. Nectar of Devotion, Rupa Goswami clearly says, one who is in the bhava stage does not fall down. But then you may say, then how it happened with Bharat Maharaj? It happened because Krishna wanted to teach us that we have to be always careful, we have to be always alert. To teach us this lesson, Krishna orchestrated this event in Bharat Maharaj's life. And we have to learn lessons from this, rather than see how Bharat Maharaj is, don't worry about Bharat Maharaj. You know, let us worry about ourselves based on this pastime. Because pastime means generally, you know, it's a Lord's arrangement. So this is the way I see it. Because Bharat Maharaj remembered the deer because Krishna wanted to teach us that the Gita Krishna says that whatever you are attached to, that is what you remember at the time of death, and whatever you remember at the time of death, that is what you will get the next life. So we have to be careful. So just to teach us the importance of being alert in your devotional practices, this pastime has been orchestrated by the Lord. And we don't have to become hopeless. You know, Krishna did take care of Bharat Maharaj, right? As a deer, he remembered the past life. How many deers you know who will remember their past life? So this is a very special pastime. Prabhupada writes in today's purport also that animals also in Vrindavan, you know, they are also special associates of the Lord. So let us not dive into Bharat Maharaj's complexity. Rather, let us learn lessons from this past. And this is the way I see it. Is that okay, Mataji? Vrinda Gopika Mataji, and then Sai Vivek Prabhu, and then Naveen Krishna Prabhu last.
Yes, sure, Prabhuji. Thank you, Prabhuji. Thank you so much. It was helpful.
Thank you, Mataji.
हरे कृष्ण प्रभुजी अनंत कोटि दंडवत प्रणाम शिल प्रभुपाद शिल गुरुदेव चिचिराता गोपीनाथ जी प्रभुजी योर क्लास इज ऑलवेज फुल ऑफ इंस्पिरेशन दैट समटाइम्स अवर दिस फिजिकल बॉडी इज नॉट सपोर्टिंग एंड वी टेक मेडिसिन प्रभुजी एंड देयर इज समथिंग इनसाइड द मेडिसिन दैट वी फील स्लीपी बट आई लेफ्ट जस्ट 3 डेज इट्स हैपन प्रभुजी नॉट एबल टू गेट अप 445, and I don't want to take that medicine. So we understand from this Bharat Maharaj, you explained so nicely that we should be very alert. And I seen that if my japa is not good, whole day, Prabhuji, oh, I have my 2-3 japa is not over. My 2 japa is not over. Better we will finish our morning japa attentively, then we can perform our daily duty more sincerely. Otherwise, man mein ek apradh reh jaye re, maine mera japa theek se nahi kiya, Gurudev ko offense kiya. So, Prabhuji, thank you very much for inspiring us. Then and every time you are explaining so many points, jo hume jagrut kar dete. So association of Vaishnava is very important, Prabhuji. And today I complete my japa in the morning, only one left, so I feel relaxed. So this is the power of association of Vaishnava. Jo hum saath mein kar sakte hai bhakti, wo akele mein nahi hota hai. At least I am very fallen soul. I need association of Vaishnava, whether it's Shri Bhagavatam, whether it's a morning japa or whether it's afternoon japa. Thank you, Prabhuji. Hari Hari Gauranga, Anant Koti Danvat Pranam.
Thank you. Yes, Sai Vivek Prabhu. I think you have asked a question on chat, right? Yeah. You are muted, so I am reading the question that you have asked on chat. Would you like to elaborate? How can we keep Krishna in center while self-preservation and self-care of material body? And is self-care good in devotional service? That's your question, right? Yes. So if we can't keep Krishna in the center of our life, at least let us include him in the circle of our life. You know, we have a big circle. We have many things we want to do in life. Fine. Allow Krishna to at least enter the circle. And then slowly he will become the center. Keep giving attention to Krishna in your circle. And Krishna will make himself the center. But if you artificially make him the center, when we have so many other aspirations and we force ourselves, you know, we'll keep struggling. So it begins with little bit. Bhakti begins, you know, allow, just stand one round, two round, begin slowly like that. And self-care is very important. One Srila Prabhupada told Tamal Krishna Maharaj, first become conscious, then become Krishna conscious. Means you become aware of who you are, you know, aware of your needs, aware of your basic, you know, psychophysical nature. So we need to spend time. And if you don't take care of ourselves, then you will see, we have to, that doesn't mean we are controllers or we are God. We just want to take care of ourselves so that we can serve Krishna nicely. Our goal when self-care is, there is a difference between, some people, you know, they say, I want to be selfless. I only serve Krishna. So in the name of being selfless, they don't take care of their body and then they suffer a lot. And some people, they're very selfish. My needs, my life. So then they go to the other extreme. Selfish and selflessness. But in between, there is something called as self-care. When I take care of myself, there is a difference between self-care and selfish. When I'm selfish, then I am the most important. Nobody else matters. When I'm self-care means I take care of myself so that I can serve others better. When you're in an airplane, the announcement is made, first put on the mask on yourself, right? And then take care of others. So self-care is very important. And we can make Krishna the center of our life if we first make him a part of our life. You know, I know one devotee who is very much addicted to cricket. And he chants 16 rounds, he does worships deities, he does everything nicely. And he is not able to give up cricket. So he said, so he said, I know what is the right thing to do. So I have told Krishna, Krishna, please forgive me. I am improving. So what he tells every time he goes to Krishna, Krishna, please help me overcome this attachment. But right now I'm attached to this. You know, some people are not able to give up. So, and he knows it is a waste of time. But if I tell him you are fallen, then he will be discouraged to practice bhakti. So somehow because of Krishna entering his life slowly, slowly. Now this was 7 years back. And today he is able to do much more devotional service. And he is not really addicted to cricket. It's like an interest he has, which is okay, but it is not disrupting his spiritual practices. So the point I'm trying to make is that self-care is important, but we cannot neglect Krishna conscious practices, and slowly and steadily we can move forward. That is the way I would like to answer your question. So one last question we can take. Thank you, Sai Vivek too.
Hare Krishna Prabhuji, Dandavat Pranam.
Thank you. Yes.
It was very enlightening class, Prabhu, especially the 3 hours and how we should be careful about the Maya. And also very practical. I have one question regarding the fault finding. Like many years ago, you gave some tips for the fault, like over how to overcome fault finding. Like, I don't know, maybe he is correct. Like, can you anything? I remember that class, but exactly I didn't remember the how it sequence goes. It will you help me, please? So that
see, you know, these techniques are all there, but ultimately it's our attitude. If we see that the devotee is also a servant of Krishna, eventually we have to overcome. You know, all the techniques we'll forget when we see faults in devotees. But there are 8 principles when you see other devotees. If I write 9 right now, 9, I will say it is 9, but you will see it as 6. From my. So first thing is he is also right, which means he is also right. That is also, he could also be right. That is one way of seeing. Second is he may not know what is right. Sometimes, you know, in our temple, they put an announcement once that nobody should steal Mahaprasad. It is for the donors. Yeah. So one devotee was stealing Mahaprasad. So I told myself, he doesn't know that announcement was made. So he does not know what is right. He is also right. And sometimes, you know, and actually one devotee said, no, I saw him in the meeting. He knows. So then I use the third principle. His intention was right. He took that, he stole that Mahaprasad to give it to somebody else.
Right.
So he doesn't know. He is also right. He doesn't know what is right. His intention is right. And fourth is, I don't know what is right.
Correct.
You know, sometimes some people behave badly despite everything. And I was like, oh, I don't know. I'm a small person. Then fifth is, the end result will be right.
Right.
Means if he's doing bad now, ultimately we learn from his mistakes and then he will become all right. And the sixth is, okay, if all the 5 you are not able to see good after the 5 steps, the 6th step is something else is right. He's stealing Mahaprasad, okay, but he does very good kirtan. Oh, he's very good. He gave a lot of money for donation last year. So something else is right. After this 6, even if the 6 is not helping, then the 7th you can do is pray for right. Krishna, please help him. Krishna, please help him. So pray for that person becomes right. If that also not helping, then the last thing I do is the 8th one. Write the right. I write journals. And when I write, all my frustration goes away because writing is very good to reduce all the frustration. So then I become peaceful, then I don't offend that devotee. So these are the 8 steps I follow. I try to follow. Okay? Thank you, Prabhu.
Nice, Prabhu. It's very nice.
I think there is, we can take one last question of Narahari Dev Prabhu. I can see one hand raised. Then,
thank you.
Okay, and then also Jala. I can see 2 more hands. So then we'll have to close because I have another program to attend. Yes, Narahari Dev Prabhu and then Jala. Yes, please.
Thank you, Prabhu, for a very nice class. So Prabhu, I actually have a question regarding the distraction that you mentioned, which is the phone. So I just wanted to understand what is a practical solution. So unlike living in a nice, wonderful environment like you have at the temple, you know, as grihasthas, I can speak of my challenge. Like, I don't have the nice association in the morning. And in the morning, generally, I wake up and I try to chant. I have my bead bag next to my bed. You know, I ideally would like to wake up, take a shower, you know, do my Mangala Arati and sit and chant. But sometimes, you know, sleeping with the kids, you know, they don't prefer. So you have to sit and chant. So I try to keep the phone where, you know, the group chat where, but sometimes what happens is notifications comes or mind gets distracted. You get the phone on and it's like it even happened today. And I was feeling very bad. And I wanted to know some practical suggestions because I'm like kind of stuck. I can't get out. I know it's a temporary phase, but at least during this temporary phase, what is it I can do? So at least my minimize.
This is my favorite topic. I have done so much research on distractions and brains and smartphones. I can speak for hours on this. But I'll tell you one practical solution. You will follow Ekadashi.
Yes, Prabhu.
So what do you do on Ekadashi? What do you eat or what do you don't eat? You don't eat grains, right?
Yes, Prabhu.
Yeah, so Ekadashi is a day when we don't eat rice, chapati, all that, right?
Mm-hmm.
Ekadashi is a day when we fast from grains. Why don't you try once in 15 days Ekadashi or from smartphone?
Okay.
Try this and see. Or you can do 6-hour fasting from smartphone. Keep the smartphone somewhere else for 6 hours and see the difference it makes to you. Basically, we need first a desire to be free from distraction, because now one of the biggest epidemics in modern times, I think, which is more deadly, honestly speaking, which is more all, I would say more deadly, that will be a controversial statement, but more all pervading than the Chinese virus is the distraction we face from our smartphones. This is taking a lot of us away from Krishna. And you know something? Distraction is not the problem. We are not able to, people say, I'm not able to focus on Krishna because I'm distracted by my smartphone. You know something? Distraction is not the reason why we are not able to focus on Krishna. Distraction is a symptom of our inability to focus on Krishna. Distraction is not the cause. Then what is the cause? The cause is overstimulation. We are living in an age when we want to be stimulated. You know, stimulation means, you know, you want to get a kick. You know, the craving for pleasure, that stimulation, that desire, that craving gets us addicted to the smartphone. It pulls us towards the smartphone. And when the notification comes, you know, that anticipation, what is there, that is called dopamine. Dopamine is not a pleasure. You know, it's not simply the happiness, pleasure chemical. Dopamine is that anticipation, craving for, like when WhatsApp, there's a ping, that sound comes, somebody sent a message. That anticipation, that craving to see the message, that is dopamine. So from morning to night, we are living in a very high dopamine kick environment. We are constantly getting stimulation. And this overstimulated lifestyle that we are leading has made us very restless and distracted. And to get benefits from bhakti practices, we need to have sustained attention. We can't be attentive for 2 minutes. Nowadays, people say give a 4-minute lecture, a 5-minute video. Why? Because we don't have the ability to pay attention for a long period of time. But bhakti benefits we get when we chant for a long period of time, when we hear class for 1 hour, 2 hours, when we absorb ourselves, we need sustained attention. So my practical suggestion would be, you know, fasting from smartphone for some time, that is one. Second, when you are not leading a stimulated life, if you're not stimulated, what will happen? What is the technical word for a life or for a time when you are not stimulated? The technical word is boredom. We are scared of being bored. So next time you are bored, welcome that boredom. Don't touch the phone. When you are bored, just sit down, look at the sky, look at the window. Just relax. Allow yourself to be bored. And then you will see, you will not have any need for being distracted by the smartphone. Because see, this stimulation, you know, we want to be highly stimulated. We want a kick. And let me tell you, you may be a grihastha. Don't think that brahmachari is because we are living in an ashram with a lot of good association. We cannot be victims of this. No, a renounce order can also be a victim of smartphone. Everybody, Maya is equal. Maya doesn't say, oh, he's wearing saffron, let me not disturb him. No, not like that. Everyone, Maya can invade everyone's life. And we all have burnt our lives. So once I asked Ravindra Swarup Prabhu, ISKCON GBC guru, about smartphone use, and he said a very simple answer. You learn how to use the smartphone perfectly by trial and error. You see yourself what helps you practice Krishna consciousness better, what is acceptable stimulation for you, what is not, and through trial and error you follow. So what I do when I get bored, when I'm not stimulated, I go and sit in the terrace of our ashram. I sit in the chair sometimes for half an hour looking at the sky, relaxing. After completing my rounds, of course, I'm assuming that, you know, sometimes everything has become a burden for us. It's become a chore. We need to relax. We need to accept life as it is, you know, rather than constantly trying to be stimulating ourselves. So if you can do that, you will see a lot of benefits. And we are cheap. We can't we think that boredom is bad. No, some of the most creative ideas I've got when I'm bored. You know, this eight things I spoke today about that mental offenses, he's also right and all of that. This I discovered because one day I was just relaxing and writing journal, relaxed way in a non-stimulated environment. And I got these ideas. So when you are always stimulated and you get this dopamine kick, then what happens is it also produces cortisol, which is a very, very, you know, overproduction of cortisol is destructive to the body because cortisol is released to help us cope with stress, but and to help us cope with the stimulated environment. But an overproduction of cortisol happens and then we get exhausted. We have, you know, sleep problems. And then to keep ourselves motivated, we again get a dopamine kick. So this volatile fluctuation of neurochemicals in the brain makes us go crazy. So therefore, we need to actually have a digital detox. We need to be away from our smartphones. Trust me, a time will come, just like 100 years back, people thought smoking was cool. And then later on, they discovered through research that smoking is injurious to health. And now it is mandatory to put it on a cigarette packet. Similarly, a very soon time will come when smartphone usage, its hazards will be made public. This is extremely dangerous, but it is useful for our services. So it is useful for our services. It is useful for devotees who don't have access to ISKCON temples. Like I hear Bhagavatam classes because of this smartphone. So many advantages because of this smartphone. So what we can do is we can have somebody become a parent for us. Somebody, you can make somebody as a parent who monitors what you are doing on your smartphone. Second, you can have a strict switch off and switch on times. You can have, you see, basically it's your desire. What is your desire? If your desire is to serve Krishna, then you can use the smartphone. Ask yourself, are you using your smartphone or is the smartphone using you?
If you're using the smartphone,
yeah, if you're using the smartphone, great, go ahead. But if you're being used by the smartphone, then stop and take some action. And it's not difficult. There are a lot of help you will get. But the first thing to do is understand that stimulation, overstimulation is not good. Relax, just learn to relax, learn to be happy when you're not stimulated. Just imagine, you know what happened recently, not recently, a few years back in Harvard, they did an experiment. Daniel Levitman's book, Organized Mind, explains this in great detail. I read that book. It's a great book. Although the title is Organized Mind, the book is not so organized, but it's a very good book. It helps us understand how the brain gets affected because of all these smartphones. So he explains how in Harvard in 2014, they did an experiment. They gave an mild electric shock to people and they had to press a button and it was mild electric shock and it was not welcome. And not surprisingly, all of them said, next time, if I had a choice of giving money and not get this shock, I would give money. So then it was accepted. Then after some time, all these people were given another experiment. They were put in a room and they were told, you can be in this room for the next 15 minutes. You just have to sit and relax. Nothing, you have to be alone. Just relax. And by the way, you don't have to, that button is there. You know, remember that you press that button, you got electric shock, mild electric shock. That is still there. So if you want, you can press it, but your time will be 15 minutes. If you want, you can do it. Like that, you don't have to do it, but it is there. And believe it or not, 91% of people, at least once they press that button and they got electric shock in those 15 minutes. When they didn't have to. And one man pressed it 190 times. That means every 5 seconds. That means much going on. Means we can't sit alone with our thoughts. We can't relax. It's crazy. You know that Pascal, mathematician, philosopher, he said 99% of the world's problems will be solved if human beings can learn to sit quietly in a room. But many of us, these people in that experiment, what it revealed was the pain you are going through is so painful, is actually less painful than the thoughts that we experience. See, this man's thoughts were so painful that he preferred physical pain. So many of us, we prefer an electric shock, something stimulating rather than being peaceful. So Krishna says in the Gita very clearly, Ashantasya Kuta Sukham, without peace, we cannot experience spiritual happiness. And peace means sattvaguna. Sattvaguna means not being stimulated. Just being present in sattvaguna. So this is one practical things. And the last thing I would like to say, because I need to go now, but I want to say one last experiment which I have done, and it has helped me a lot. Earlier, I used to go for my walk in the evenings or mornings, and I used to chant my japa. I know that you may have paucity of time, but I tried one thing. I stopped chanting while walking. I chanted exclusively. And while walking, I decided to simply look at the sky, look at the trees, hear the sounds, just be present. I try to practice present moment awareness, mindfulness. Mindfulness is the thing nowadays. Everybody is talking about mindfulness. But mindfulness is very simple. Mindfulness simply means being present with a conscious choice, with a purpose, and without judgment. So when I did that, I was looking at the trees and the birds. I was trying to look at them as if I'm looking at them for the first time. Or the last time. Just imagine if you're going to see something for the last time in your life, how attentively we will see. So looking at everything or listening to everything, this is a way we could chant also, as if I'm listening to the Hare Krishna Maha Mantra last time or the first time. So when I did that, there were two things that used to really bother me in Mumbai. I live in Mumbai, and two things used to irritate me a lot. For the last 10 years, I've suffered because of this. And one is the sound of the crow's cawing. Right outside my room, the crows are constantly cawing. And the traffic horns in Mumbai, they are not like the Western countries, where nobody honks. Where everybody's honking. It's very irritating. And trust me, because of this present moment awareness practices, now the crows cawing and the traffic horn doesn't disturb me. I have become indifferent to it. I have experienced a certain kind of peace because I voluntarily chose not to be stimulated. I gave up multitasking and tried to do things in a present state. So I'm not saying I've achieved perfection, but I'm working on it. So the point I'm trying to make is that we can, if you start practicing present moment awareness through your japa, through other activities, and keep your smartphone away for some time, or you can keep it on a silent mode or things like that, then you can ensure that you are less stimulated, and that will help you be more peaceful. Is that okay, Prabhu? There is no end to this discussion. Yes, I would like to stop here. Thank you very much for your time, and I'm very grateful to all of you for giving me an opportunity to serve you today. And I'm sorry if I've spoken anything which has disturbed anyone. Hare Krishna.
Thank you so much, Prabhuji. Very nice class. Beautiful. Excellent. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, Prabhu. So many day-to-day for everybody who go through all these things, and it is very nicely explained and very practical also to put in practice and increase our devotion and come closer to Krishna. Thank you so much, Prabhu. Thank you also.